Tonight, the Prime Minister announces the official resignation of Public Service Minister Ubaldus Raymond. Government defends its overhaul of the Jazz Festival as it decides on the way forward for the event. St. Lucia gets help from Morocco to improve local soil fertility and with it, crop yield and quality. And the Women's Support Center gets a generous donation from the Make It Happen Foundation. A very good evening to you. Welcome to the Monday edition of the DBS News World. My name is Timothy Polion. Prime Minister Alan Chastney has accepted the resignation of Minister with Responsibility for the Public Service, Dr. Ubaldus Raymond, with immediate effect. In a statement issued by the Prime Minister following today's cabinet meeting, he said the decision was taken in the best interest of all parties and the country. The Prime Minister says Dr. Raymond has served the country well and in several capacities, including Leader of Government Business in the Senate and previously as Minister in the Ministry of Finance. He thanked him and his family for his years of service to the country and their support of him. He, however, cautioned that the acceptance of the resignation in no way affects the ongoing investigations into allegations of impropriety by the minister. He says the government remains committed to bringing closure to the matter. Dr. Raymond, who was the focus of a blackmail case in 2017 involving two teenagers, has found himself embroiled in another scandal involving the circulation of nude photographs and recordings of telephone conversations with a woman, not his wife. In other news, police are investigating the circumstances surrounding the death of Ronald Weeks as a result of a vehicle accident which occurred at about 4:55 p.m. on Saturday, 27th April 2019 at the VG roundabout in Castries. Weeks, a 72-year-old resident of Sunny Acres, Castries, was the sole occupant of an SUV registration number PC7625. He was conveyed to the Victoria Hospital and later succumbed to his injuries. A post-mortem examination is scheduled for a later date. This was the 8th road fatality for this year. The final touches are being put to the jazz component of the annual Soleil Summer Festival series. It is an important festival for the government for a number of reasons. For one, it will determine the shape of future festivals, and for another, it is an opportunity for the administration to vindicate itself and its decision to overhaul the annual event. According to Culture Minister Senator Fortuna Bellrose, all indicators are positive. We hear more in this report.
The government was heavily criticized for its decision to reconfigure the St. Lucia Jazz Festival. The decision to overhaul the decades-old festival did not go down well, but government insisted that the $14 million budget spent on the festival was not money well spent. Apart from establishing a new entity to manage the event, it announced a major budget cut and the inclusion of the Jazz Festival on a list of other festivals under the Soleil Festival's banner. Both the Prime Minister and the Culture Minister appealed for patience, saying the new strategy would need time to be tested. That time is almost up.
We're moving towards the end. This year would end the piloting of the Jazz Festival in the way that we would want, or we wanted to as a government. This year ends that.
The hope is that at the end of this pilot phase, that there will be agreement that the new approach has worked, despite the major budget cut. In fact, the minister insists that even on a smaller operating budget, the government has been able to achieve far more, especially through investment in local talent. Local contracting reportedly accounts for up to 70% of the jazz budget.
What will work for us now is the fact that we have the smaller intimate venues, we have our local people really into it, we have our children who are coming up in the orchestras playing. So there are lots of opportunities, and I hope that you could capture all of that this year, you know, as we look to crystallize and put it through in years to come. So we've seen an increase in the number of persons purchasing tickets for the jazz. I think for us as a government and as a country, what we're looking for is strengthening that base of the programming. So when I talk about the children from Marsha and the School of Music, you know, you really cannot measure those things in terms of the depth of the programming. You can't put a cost to that, you know, and so that is an investment you're making with respect to your future in music and in jazz, in the jazz festival. So that's a big investment here.
A major bonus this year is the partnership between the local events company and Jazz at Lincoln Center. That collaboration will see some of the biggest and best names in modern jazz performing in a variety of intimate venues and public settings across the island. That's between Sunday, May 5th and Sunday, May 12th, when the curtains come down on the festival. This year's event has attracted the likes of Christian McBride, Ledisi, Etienne Charles, Russell Hall, and Patrick Bartley. For the DBS News World, Kendall Burton reporting.
Meanwhile, organizers of St. Lucia Jazz say the 2019 edition of the event is said to be one of the biggest in a decades-old festival's history. This is after a number of changes to the format of the event, leaving organizers with what they believe is a winning formula. This year's event has been able to attract a great deal of international coverage and attention.
The international response has been amazing. We've done a number of launches. We've done a launch in London. We did a launch in Toronto and in Montreal. At the New York launch, which actually coincided with Mardi Gras, it was an amazing reception from the press, where we had really some of the largest names that were in attendance. And then recently, we've done a press launch in Martinique, which even from our neighbors, they're really excited about this this refiguration and this rebooting of the Jazz Festival in St. Lucia. For us, we are really excited that this festival is going to be something that's going to be taking place all over the island, and not just with international artists, but also with our local artists as well.
St. Lucia Jazz has even caught the attention of music legend Quincy Jones, who tweeted about the festival recently, giving two thumbs up to the lineup for the event, which will feature the likes of Ledisi and Gregory Porter.
The New York Times has run articles, and we're expecting a really, really large and important reception from an engagement from the international media. Just to let you know, we're going to be having The New Yorker, a journalist from The New Yorker magazine, Lonely Planet, Maxim, the Philadelphia Tribune, The New York Post from the US. We're going to be having Jazz FM from the UK, Jazzwise, New Magazine, Flush Magazine, BBC.
This year, organizers have opted for a number of intimate venues around the island, as opposed to the usual main stage events, in a bid to decentralize the festival. The event kicks off this weekend with West Coast Jazz in Anstoray on Friday. On Sunday, the focus will be on Rudy John Beach in Labrie, where a free event featuring saxophonist Yolanda Brown will be held. Also performing in Labrie will be Extra Love and Friends from St. Lucia. Still in the first segment of the broadcast, Street Vibes.
Hi, I'm Alex Bosque, and you're watching Street Vibes. Today, the people speak to an open mic.
Healthcare is not good at all, it's very bad.
Why would you say so?
Well, because I am seeing what is going on. Because let us say that I have a problem. I went to the hospital, they wrote my paper for me very well. They tell me take it to the NIC. I took it there. They write it down, they send me back to the hospital, right? Hospital send me back to them, and up to now I can't get any reply from them yet.
Neither one, neither the other.
So what they been, my son had went with me. They tell me in a week time I would get everything settled. And I believe it's about 3 to 4 weeks now since I can't get nothing settled. So I had to send my son back and ask them if they forget me.
My problem is with the state, St. Lucia government, any government, red, blue, green, black, it doesn't matter, any government. We had it under John Compton, we should bring it back again. We have so many prisoners eating our tax dollars, and we complaining we don't have money for road repairs, retaining walls, barriers, and all these kind of things. We should have some of these people that are borderly to come and do that work on the street side. That will help government to save a dollar and for them to check for other poor people that live in places like, you know, the poor people. That's what I want the state to do. That making sense. You're supposed to bring it back. Even I myself at Borderly, I want to be out there helping the state. I want to do it because I'm not a lazy person. That's what I want y'all to bring back. Too many people eating our tax dollars and it just they're getting fat.
Why the present government, okay, allowing when you go and look for the contract template, they act, they're not giving you because they're bit supporting the next party?
I think with us in St. Lucia right now, what we need to do, we need to accept the fact that we need to learn to accept change. We have a culture of not accepting change. And as a St. Lucian, I realize that is one of our main detriment. We refuse to accept change. And the powers that be, our politicians, doesn't make it easier for us. They know the truth, but they refuse to tell us. And that again helps the culture of not accepting change.
Well, there you have it. You've just been watching Street Vibes with me, Alex Busque, down here at the Aquarius Crossing, the intersection of Coral and St. Louis Streets. With that, we'll take you back to our studio.
Thank you very much. You're watching St. Lucia's television and news leader. You can also listen to us on Rhythm FM 95.5 and the Wave 94.5 and 93.7 FM. We are also online and the big screen at the Aquarius Crossing in downtown Castries. When we come back, another busy weekend for emergency responders and a 19-year-old charged for the death of a businessman. Welcome back. Thank you so much for staying with the DBS News World. The St. Lucia Fire and Emergency Service responded to 80 ambulance calls over the weekend. 76 of those calls were for medical emergencies. These medical emergencies included 5 motor vehicle accidents and 2 physical assaults.
On Saturday, 27 April, at approximately 8:55 p.m., firefighters from the Viewfort Fire Station responded to a motor vehicle collision on the Viewfort Castries Highway, next to the stadium. That incident involved a Suzuki SUV and a motor car. On arrival at the scene, emergency personnel assessed and treated the driver of the motor car. He was subsequently transported to the St. Jude's Hospital for further medical care. The 2 other victims of the accidents were transported to the St. Jude's Hospital by private means.
On Sunday, April 28th at about 7:23 p.m., fire officers of the Castries Fire Station responded to a motor vehicle accident in Bexhill. The collision involved a Mitsubishi pickup and a Nissan Almera.
On arrival at the scene, fire officers were able to assess and treat the victims for the injuries sustained. They were subsequently transported to the Victoria Hospital for further medical care. Also, the St. Lucia Fire Service responded to 7 fire calls, including 2 structurals and 5 bushfires. On Friday, 26 April, at approximately 10:10 p.m., fire officers from the Castries Fire Station responded to a structural fire in Bexon. That incident involved a wooden grocery shop measuring 12 by 14 feet.
On arrival on the scene, fire officers found the structure fully engulfed. They were able to quickly control and subsequently extinguish the fire, preventing it from spreading to adjacent structures. And now this. A 19-year-old has been formally charged for the death of a Cedars businessman who was shot and killed last month. On a Saturday, April 27th, 2019, Ruben Ishmael, a resident of Marshall, was formally arrested and charged for causing the death of Joseph Stanislaus Pistol. Pistol was fatally shot at Cedars Castries on Wednesday, March 13th this year. Ruben Ishmael was escorted to the First District Court, where he was remanded into custody. St. Lucia is getting much-needed help from the Moroccan government to improve local soil fertility. Soil fertility and nutrient management is one of the important factors that have a direct impact on crop yield and quality. The Ministry of Agriculture welcomed a delegation from Morocco to discuss the way forward for the final phase of the project, which ends in March 2021. We hear more in this report.
A meeting of principal officers implementing a soil fertility project in St. Lucia met this week to revise plans to ensure the final leg of work is completed to satisfaction. The delegation comprising the Ambassador of the Kingdom of Morocco to St. Lucia, His Excellency Abderrahim Kadmiri, and a technical team from the Department of Agriculture, headed by the Honorable Minister Ezekiel Joseph, met to review the plan of action for the completion phase of the Moroccan Soil Fertility Project, all with the expectation of improving soil health conditions and boosting agriculture production efforts in St. Lucia.
Institutions in charge of this very, very crucial project, namely the National Institute of Agronomic Research, the Moroccan Agency for International Cooperation, and the OCP Foundation. When you speak about OCP, just retain in mind phosphate. P, this is the first letter, that, you know, reflects, I mean, the importance of Rufeid for Morocco and what Morocco has been doing, of course, to let our friends in a very specific areas in the world benefiting of that very important, you know, item. Important not only for agriculture but for other, you know, activities, of course, related to agriculture.
Minister for Agriculture Honorable Ezekiel Joseph says, by fine-tuning the ongoing work under the Soil Fertility Project, the final phase will ensure that St. Lucia makes the most use of not only technology transfer and application techniques, but ultimately impact the overall performance of our agriculture economy.
Well, two of the major programs we have, one is our banner rehabilitation program. What we are getting from the farmers is that there's need for us to do the analysis as far as the soil's conditions are concerned and to know exactly what type of interventions that we can do based on the results of this analysis. And critical for us this year, and I can speak to it, is our veritable import substitution program, where we have targeted 7 crops where we would want to give support to our farmers as far as new technology, improved technology, and of course to the whole aspect of extension and training, and linking it back to the whole aspect of the marketing entity that we are now restructuring, our marketing board, which have been around for over 45 years.
The Moroccan Soil Fertility Project was extended for another year. An end date of March 2021 has been agreed upon. From the Ministry of Agriculture, I am Amanda Fay-Clark reporting.
The ability of abused women to start over after escaping their tormentors got a little easier thanks to the generosity of the Make It Happen Foundation. The foundation, which was started by the Prime Minister's wife, has been instrumental in improving conditions at local fire and police stations. This week, however, it was the Women's Support Center which received the check to assist it in accomplishing its mandate.
The cheque for $15,000 was hand-delivered to the manager of the centre by the Prime Minister's wife at a brief ceremony on Monday. The centre offers critical assistance to victims of domestic violence by helping them break free from their abusers. But like many organisations across the world feeling the effects of an economic downturn, the centre is trying to do a lot with very little resources.
The shelter was established in 2001. It is a shelter that provides temporary housing accommodation for women and their children, women who are victims of intimate partner abuse. When those women come to the center for refuge, we provide counseling for them. We take a holistic approach. We also have to provide for all of their needs, because very often when those women run from their homes, they live with nothing.
Apart from meeting the immediate needs of abuse survivors and their children through services like housing, mental health counseling, and legal assistance, the center continues to offer a variety of support services to victims outside of the organization's walls. The assistance from the Make It Happen Foundation will put a small dent in the cost of offering those services. The funds were raised during the organization's recent tea and testimony event at Government House.
It was really an opportunity for women to share with each other, to celebrate Women's Day on March 8th, but to also hear the stories of other women who had been successful or who had been through some kind of struggle and overcome. So it was more than just fashion and getting dressed up. It was about coming together and sharing with each other.
The recent Tea and Testimony event is just one of the initiatives being undertaken by the Make It Happen Foundation. While its initial fundraisers benefited police and fire stations, local nurses and several schools have also benefited.
We have built a couple of libraries and some small schools, and we've done some other remedial works as and where necessary. We are now in the process of identifying a school. Actually, this week, I've spoken with some persons this week to identify a school in the Castries Basin. The British naval ship will be here in May, and they've offered to paint a school in the Castries Basin. So our foundation has agreed to purchase the paint and the materials to do that, and we will get the labor for free. So that's going to be happening in the coming weeks.
The main objective of the organization is to help meet some of the gaps in governmental support to affect infrastructural works across sectors. The foundation's biggest fundraiser is the Officers' Ball, which is held every December. The bulk of the funds raised go toward assisting police and fire officers. Conversations have already taken place with the administrators of the police and fire departments to identify their most urgent needs. For the DBS News World, Kendall Burton reporting.
The Monsignor Patrick Anthony Folk Research Center, FRC, launched its first major fundraiser to help rebuild its headquarters today. The event titled FRC Viva Groovy Socalypso was formally launched at the Financial Administrative Center in Point Serafin. The FRC headquarters, along with four decades of research and other material, was destroyed by fire last year.
The concept of the concert was determined because of the long-standing relationship between the FRC and the Calypso fraternity. The FRC has published the Lucian Caiso magazine annually from 1990. The organization has always recognized the art forms of soca, calypso, and now the Denry segment as an important part of the St. Lucian heritage and culture that needs to be preserved and archived.
Our socalypso, groovy socalypso show, which is scheduled to take place on the 9th of June at the Pigeon Island National Park. Now, this is a fundraiser for the FRC. As you're aware, last year, the 25th of March, the FRC went up in flames, and we want to rebuild that place. And we are in the process. In fact, just this year, this, on the anniversary, we launch a rebuilding fund. And the first activity to raise funds for the rebuilding of our FRC's headquarters is taking place on the 9th. And so we're using this opportunity to have this media launch to inform the public of that show. We're hoping that all the St. Lucians would rally behind the FRC and support that show. It's important that they do this because it means that we're able to rebuild our institution and for going forward, we can ensure ourselves that we will be alive, and we have this tagline that says FRC Viva.
The national artists lending their support to the rebuilding of the FRC are T.C. Brown, Ricky T., Afa Alain, Alpha, Mighty and Subans, and the backup bands on board for the event are the DYP and Extreme Band with Brass. The MCs will be Ezai Hall and Linda Chocolate Berthier. The executive director of the FRC says there are already plans to host another show in Martinique.
We also intend to have a show in Martinique, and that we've already spoken to the attaché out there, and she's quite excited that she'll arrange another show in Martinique, all aimed at raising funds for the rebuilding of FRC.
The media, corporate St. Lucia, and the general public are asked to support this major fundraising effort on Sunday, June 9th, 2019. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Bousquet.
Regional youth begin meeting in St. Lucia. We'll tell you more in just a moment. Holiday Taxi Association has a new executive. The new team was voted in at the organization's annual general meeting on Saturday evening.
What we represent is pretty much a new era for Holiday Taxi. Our intention is to move the organization forward. I know it's a tough challenge ahead, but I think every one of us is committed to this challenge and try our best to represent the persons who are the shareholders who voted us on Saturday night, to do everything in their best interest. We insist that we wanted secret ballot in order for it to be fair. That's the only time you'll know if you fairly elected. And the matter, we had to take it to court. And there are other issues we still have in court, but then this one was settled where the vote must be by secret ballot. And hence today the shareholders, came out and vote because it was a secret ballot vote. And this is why that they elected a new group of persons to represent them.
The new president is Mr. Laurie Antoine, who happens to be the only one re-elected from the former board.
Laurie Antoine, president, Robert Louis, vice president, Michael Flood, secretary, Constantius Francois, assistant secretary, Leon Eugene as treasurer, and Norbert Charles as assistant treasurer. Hugo Alcide, trustee.
Mr. Francois says the association's lawyer, Warnie Harris, and fellow attorney, Veronica Barnard, were instrumental in the outcome of Saturday's meeting. The second annual Caribbean Youth Conference got underway in St. Lucia. The conference brings together delegates from across the region to discuss a range of issues affecting young people with governmental and other leaders. Alex Bousquet tells us more.
The second vice president of the NYC, who is also the outreach coordinator of the Caribbean Youth Conference, says this conference gives marginalized youth a voice. It is also an opportunity to sell the NYC as an organization which is relevant and ready and willing to advocate on behalf of youth.
So we use this opportunity as well as a time to send out a message that the National Youth Council is present and ready to serve the young people of St. Lucia. Tomorrow we will be hosting an event which is called the Straight Up Talks, and this is where we will bring in our policymakers to speak directly to our young people. So we are really willing to have these discussions. We're really looking forward to the outcomes of this conference, and we want to also make a call to policymakers that the outcomes of this conference will be relevant to the modern day young person.
The conference, Mr. LeBon says, will get young people ready to participate effectively in the development of their countries.
The plans that the young people have come together to develop at this conference may be relevant to whoever, you know, party may be willing to bring on some of these ideas as well. So this is all prepared to give these youth chances, to give these youth opportunities. And this year we're looking to also ensure that these youth are part of outreach activities, and this will be happening on the 1st of May, where youth will go into Groseley, Castries, Fuford, all vulnerable communities to execute youth programs and projects so that they could see the direct impact of their efforts as well.
The second annual Caribbean Youth Conference opened at the Golden Palm Conference Room at Rodney Heights on Monday. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Bousquet.
Some entertainment news. One of the headliners for Tuesday's legacy concert, Farmer Nappy, arrived on St. Lucia today. The show, organized by Pioneer Productions, will feature from Trinidad and Tobago singing Sandra and Farmer Nappy, St. Lucia's groovy soca stars Teddison John, Arthur and Alpha, as well as Calypso Monarch T.C. Brown and others. Farmer Nappy from Trinidad, who is well known for tracks like Hookin' Me, My House and Big People, the party is excited to get on stage.
I always in St. Lucia. This is why I'm million time in St. Lucia. So St. Lucia is nice coming in early in the morning. So I'm here. I'm in Legacy tomorrow night, you know. Tuesday night, I'm up with like, people like singing Sandra on the show, you know. So Legacy mean elder crowds. Farmer Nappy sing for the ladies, you know. He's up close and personal with the ladies. So I'm here for the ladies. So ladies, anytime you see Farmer Nappy or you hear Farmer Nappy in your country, it's a ladies' night out.
The show takes place on the side lawn of Gaiety Gardens, where patrons will have the options of standing to line and party or being seated while enjoying the event. One local business is doing its part to reach out to the less fortunate by donating several hampers. We hear more.
The company All Steel Roofing believes that businesses that give back are businesses that thrive and grow. It's the reason the company has thrown its support behind a number of individuals and activities over the years.
Basically, what we realize is that passing around and look, seeing a few people, we consider that we decide to go out there and give back to the public a contribution of what we've done and stuff like that.
A total of 19 hampers were distributed, along with special gifts to a select group of loyal customers from Mikud North.
We just wanted to take this opportunity to give back to the community. So we're also getting the kids involved so that they're part of the sharing and they understand what it is to give back. It's not all about taking and taking and taking. You have to give back sometimes.
Giving back to the community just is like a bonus for me to see that they're actually more than just a company. They're actually family and they do care about the community and their people.
The company manufactures roofing material and tiling, but also does contract work for the St. Lucia Electricity Services Limited, Lucilec, by doing new connections, disconnections, and pole and line maintenance. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Bousquet.
Sports is next, so please stay with us. Time now for commentary. Here's your presenter.
According to the social philosopher Jay Austin, if a determinate human superior, not in the habit of obedience to a like superior, receive habitual obedience from the bulk of a given society, that determinate superior is sovereign in that society. And the society, including the superior, is a society political and independent. End of quote. We in St. Lucia are a society political and independent. No one could deny that. Obviously, though, in St. Lucia, the term sovereign could not be used to refer to any individual. Neither the Governor General nor the Prime Minister, whomever he or she might be at any point in time, could claim the obedience of the whole community. Sovereignty could, however, in this sense, refer to the Parliament. One philosopher, when he referred to the sovereign in a state, explained the use of the word as follows. By sovereign, I mean any person or assemblage of persons to whose will a whole political community are supposed to be in a disposition to pay obedience. As it stands in this political community, under this type of democracy, once we cast our vote at election time, we voluntarily subject ourselves to the legislature as sovereign. We pass over all power of governance to the parliamentary representatives. They, answerable to no one. They enact the law. They set the governing policy. They contract on our behalf and conduct our affairs accordingly. Whatever decisions they make, we enjoy the benefits or suffer the consequences, whichever comes. So is this where we are at this time, on this date, in this period of our supposedly political maturity? A nation of lowly subjects, subjected to the will of our sovereign? St. Lucia, at this point in time, can we be certain that our sovereign has the ability to reason? Which raises the question of the legitimacy of government. We exist by the social contract, where every person submits to the governance of an elected body, which accepts responsibility for the preservation of social order and the betterment of the lives of its citizens. Our submission to legislative government is contingent on government's ability to provide protection for the life, health, liberty, and possessions of every one of us. Government, therefore, cannot take our act of submission as a blind surrender of all of our natural rights. We must be assured that the elected government is functional and that at the least they are working toward the preservation of social order and the welfare of all citizens. We cannot exist by the notion, hear no evil, see no evil, speak no evil. When they commit wrong, when they fail us, we must speak out against their wrong and indiscretion. The words we and our are being used very loosely here, because you and I, John Public and Lucia Lucian, we have very little to say, if any, in legislative matters or in anything else that they do. Never mind the rhetoric that the parliamentarians are elected by our vote and therefore must do our bidding. Who believes that? How many of the legislative acts passed in the parliament do we hear anything of before they become law? And after they are passed, if the laws do not affect us directly in our business or in our daily affairs, when do we ever become aware of them? So what do we do? If during a legislative term the voting public has reason to be unhappy with the decisions of the government, or with the performance of any government minister, what changes may we make? What can we do other than complain? And to whom do we complain? Are we now bound by the pact that we signed at our last election poll, regardless of the prevailing circumstances? How do we fix the system if it fails us? St. Lucia, are we thinking about these things and looking for urgent solutions? Or are we continuing to pray for divine intervention? For commentary, I am Lorraine Deborah Glass.
And now, the usual reminder. The Prime Minister announces the official resignation of Public Service Minister Ubaldus Raymond. Government defends its overhaul of the Jazz Festival as it decides on the way forward for the event. St. Lucia gets help from Morocco to improve local soil fertility and, with it, crop yield and quality. And the Women's Support Center gets a generous donation from the Make It Happen Foundation. That's the broadcast. Thank you so much for watching and listening to the DBS News World. On behalf of the entire news team, I'm Timothy Polion, wishing you a very good evening. Join us tomorrow morning at 6 o'clock for our next news major. And you can join me tomorrow afternoon between 12:30 and 2 o'clock on Real FM 91.3 North and 91.5 South for News Spin. Good night and see you next time.